Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of On the Mark here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and our first guest today is well known to TV viewers throughout Western Massachusetts, TV veteran Ray Herschel. It's always good to see Ray, and I realize that although I only get to see you on the screen on Connecting Point on New England Public Media, the last time we really got to chat was when I had my cronies from the Capitol Steps come down to Hampden Street to tape a program with you, and it was my first official leaving the house work assignment after having an accident, and you and your producer Tony Dunn let me sit in the control booth and watch the taping of that wonderful program on the Capitol steps. And it was the first time I had actually driven a car or walked after weeks and weeks of being on my back. So now I stand and I walk, and it's great to have you back.
Mark, it's a pleasure always to talk with you. And I certainly remember that day where you brought your two friends in from Capitol Steps, and we had a heck of a good time on that show. They were just delightful. Unfortunately, we lost one of those actors.
Yes, we did. Dolores King Williams passed away rather unexpectedly at the beginning of the year. And in January, the Capitol Steps decided that with the pandemic and their inability to do live programming, at least through the end of this year, they decided to disband, which has made a lot of us very unhappy.
Yeah, I know. And I always look forward to seeing Capitol Steps every summer in the Berkshires. They had a wonderful crew and a great cast, so talented, and they could poke fun in a bipartisan way at our political leaders, whether they be Republicans or Democrats, but they did it in kind of an objective bipartisan way and gave the audience a lot of laughs. And we needed that, given the political atmosphere that's going on these days in our country. But it was always a pleasure to see the Capitol Steps folks, and indeed a particular pleasure when I had an opportunity to talk to two of them on the Connecting Point show, and you so beautifully organized and worked up for us.
They always enjoyed coming down and doing Connecting Point. They had done one with Tony Dunn. They loved the Berkshires, and they're certainly going to miss that. But for over 12 years, Cranwell in the Berkshires was their summer home.
Sure.
So, Ray, I thought you retired from TV when you retired from Channel 40, Western Mass News, a couple of years ago, and then you bounced right back and are doing Connecting Point. I guess you couldn't get away from the studio, huh?
You know, it's funny, Mark, because when I retired back in April of 2018, It'll be 3 years ago next month. I thought I had retired from television as well. after 50 years as a news journalist and reporter in the Springfield area. And lo and behold, about a year after my retirement, I got a call from Tony Dunn, the executive producer for Connecting Point at PBS, New England Public Media. And he informed me that their host, Connecting Point, Carrie Saldo at the time, was going on maternity leave. And they were wondering if I would be interested in coming in on a temporary basis to host their political show, which at the time was called The State We're In. It aired on Fridays on NEPM. So I thought about it, talked with my wife about it. And lo and behold, I said, you know what? I think I'll give it a try. I've always enjoyed the political scene, and I really enjoy public television. And a lot of the folks that that are working at PBS now, I had an opportunity to work with at Channel 40. Even Tony Dunn, the executive producer, worked as a producer at Channel 40, producing one of the newscasts that I was involved with. And there were a couple of other folks are there as well who worked at Channel 40. So in a way, it was sort of a little bit of a homecoming for me, if you will. But the pace is so much better for me in terms of where I am in my career. And I enjoy the concept of the show, the Connecting Point show, the stories they have on. And I sort of focus on the political stories for them. And to this day, I'm still doing some political segments for Connecting Point and very much enjoy it. So it really worked out well for me. It keeps me in the game a little bit. It's a good activity for me, keeps my mind active, and You know, it beats just sitting home looking at the walls.
What's the difference for you as a journalist working in commercial television versus public television?
Well, as you know, when I worked in commercial television, I worked at ABC 40 and eventually became ABC 40, Fox 6, and we had Channel 3 in Springfield, all lumped into one, a little bit of a regional network there. And when you do commercial television and you work on news every day, it's an intense undertaking and intense pace. You're always looking for stories, for scoops, for information on a daily basis. You know, we'd go out in the morning and have to put out two fresh stories every day for the newscast that evening. And you were pretty much, you know, out there with a photographer kind of fending for yourself, trying to put these stories together under sometimes very adverse conditions. On the other hand, with the Connecting Point program, it's an opportunity for me to work at my own pace, Mark. If I decide, for example, we're going to do an interview, let's say, with Congressman Neal next week on the stimulus package that was passed. That's what we're working on this week for next week. You know, I'll put a call into his public relations person, try to arrange it on a time that's suitable for me and for the people at 57, arrange the interview. And then over the past year, of course, we've had to do all our interviews with Zoom instead of having the guests come to the studio. So that, in a way, has made it a little bit more convenient for the people we're interviewing in case they're out of the area or not back in town yet. So the pace is totally night and day when it comes to commercial television news and putting newscasts out every day, getting information to a more a kind of a relaxed but yet informative way of working on Connecting Point, where you do have a little more time to develop an interview. When I was doing the political show, we had a 30-minute segment. Now I'm doing some segments for Connecting Point on politics that range about 10 minutes long. So that gives you an opportunity to sit down with a person and do a little bit of an in-depth interview and get more in-depth on the issues of the day and so forth than news, where you're doing basically a 90-second story, you know, two stories a day. So it, things, you know, move quickly, and it's very much of a different pace.
How do you, when was the last time you interviewed somebody face-to-face in the studio?
That was, it might have been the Congressman Neal Alex Morris debate we had during the campaign. Remember that last year?
Right.
Very hard-fought, a hard-fought campaign. And we had both of them in under you know, strict conditions. They were separated. We were separated. The reporters in the studio were separated. We socially distanced. And that was the last time we had, I had people in the studio doing it. And that was much better with the debate, having the, obviously the candidates in the studio where you could see, react to them and so forth. So, and after that, it was strictly Zoom. And to this day, Mark, we're still doing Zoom interviews. They're very strict about social distancing and the COVID-19 thing. So hopefully things will break in the coming months when we get more and more people vaccinated and are able to get out and about. But it's been a while since we've done in-studio interviews.
Yeah, the last in-studio interview I did was in April of last year before we went to phone and Zoom. And then at right before Thanksgiving this year, I had somebody in the studio where we were able to socially distance and all that. But it's very, in some ways, it's very convenient to have Zoom, and I've gotten used to it. But I miss the face-to-face interaction that we all really cherish when we're doing interviews.
I do too, and there is a distinct difference when you're in the studio with somebody and sitting opposite them, where you can look at them, you can read their body language, and you can the avenue of communication is much, much better that way, as opposed to a Zoom interview. It's a little more objective and less personal. So I much prefer the in-studio personal touch myself.
The industry has really changed since you started, not only from technology point of view. I mean, you couldn't go out and do a lot of remote locations when you started. When I got involved in Well, I haven't really done much television other than here, but I got involved in radio in the mid-1980s. You saw crews going out with heavy cameras and all of that. And now, you know, you see digi reporters going out with lightweight equipment and being able to go. But the whole tenor of the news and the media has changed in the last few years. And during the last four, we've all of us in media have been villainized by politicians as being fake news and bad media and this and that. What do you think are the triumphs of the business or areas that we've really been able to survive and prosper over the last few years?
Yeah, it's been an ongoing challenge and effort, and I certainly don't envy the reporters of today who have to go out day in and day out and, as you say, take some of this vilification and abuse at times. And it is unfortunate that we are seeing such partisanship in our country, not only through politicians, Republicans and Democrats going after each other, but people themselves, the voters who are on one end of the political spectrum or the other. I've never seen such vilification, such hatred spewing about against each other through social media, cable news stations and that sort of thing. So it is really discouraging, and it puts the reporter right in the crosshairs of that vitriol, if you will, Mark. It makes it very, very difficult to reporter to try to do a job when you've got so much animosity going on around you. And it's, I give the reporters today a lot of credit. They have to put up with a lot. They have to dig hard. And they really have to try to focus and stay objective to their cause, which is really to seek out the truth and present the facts on both sides objectively. But it's certainly a challenge to do that today, more so than ever, I would say.
Where do you get most of your news these days? Are you a newspaper reader, radio listener, TV viewer?
Yeah, all of the above. Personally, I subscribe to the newspapers, which I get every day. I get some Sunday newspapers as well. I do a lot of online searching. I've got different apps, news apps that I look after. Watch the television news, some of the shows. So it's a combination of everything, Mark, that you try to absorb in a fairly comprehensive and objective way. So, I'm constantly looking for angles, for stories, and so forth for the show. So it's a combination. You kind of just, see what's going on during the day and use the newspapers, the radio, the television, all in one.
It's interesting because I have been doing a segment here on the Mark called What Young People Think, and we have students. We've had several from Western New England University, some from Westfield State, that are journalism or communications, PR, broadcast majors. A lot of them never hold a newspaper in their hands. They read everything on their phones or listen to everything on their phones. Do you still pick up and actually hold a newspaper, or are you reading it on a tablet?
100%, Mark. I get the newspaper 7 days a week. It's delivered to my house, and I cannot have my morning coffee without putting the newspaper on the table, opening it up, spreading it out, and reading it. So I'm old school in that sense. So I do start the day reading a newspaper as much as I possibly can. I just like the relaxed atmosphere. I like sipping my coffee, looking at the newspaper, going through some of the stories. And then, during the course of the day, in terms of updates and breaking news and that sort of thing, I will go to my iPhone, check the apps, and see what's going on with news headlines and that sort of thing. So I know exactly what you mean, because a lot of young people are getting their information, their news, right on that iPhone they have, with the apps they have, and they can watch stories, they can watch news any time of day or night, given that iPhone and that social media connection. So that, in a way, has opened up a little bit of information for young people as well, and then they can access stories and news pretty much when they want to as a result of social media.
That's one of the big conveniences for me because of my work schedule. I happen to be very partial to the PBS NewsHour for my nightly news, but my nightly news can be 6 o'clock, 6:30, 7, 7:30, whenever I want to watch it on my tablet. And so I find myself sometimes sitting outside or, you know, late at night or sitting at the pool and watching my news on my phone or my tablet as opposed to sitting in front of a tube.
It's so much more convenient that way as well. And also we have this thing called DVR now.
Yeah, and, we do.
And if you're not around the house or you're doing something, I'm DVRing the nightly news every night. And then, you know, at my convenience, whether I come in a little later when I'm eating supper or whatever, be able to watch the news on my own terms, my own time that's convenient to me. So, you know, between the DVR technology and the social media and the apps and the iPhones, you're right. You can access news 24/7, basically 365 days a year when you so desire. So that has opened up a whole new area of information gathering for the public.
There's so much difference in news formats today, not only in the presentation of news. The cable stations are doing news and opinion 24/7, things like that. Are there any people, journalists, that are up and coming today that you really admire for the work that they're doing?
Yeah, I think some of the folks on the network news, being an old ABC guy at Channel 40, we watched the evening news with David Muir, and it amazes me the good young reporters they have on the network level who produce day in and day out. CNN has got some great young reporters, got some great journalists on that network as well. So there are up and coming journalists, and it is a very, very competitive business, as you certainly well know. So there are young people out there who are really doing a good job and, you know, are getting the recognition they certainly deserve at the network level. But it's a long struggle. It's a hard struggle because it is a very, very competitive business, as you know, today. But there are good journalists that are on the air on television, certainly through various networks, you know, not just ABC, obviously, but other networks as well. And you raise a good point a little bit before, Mark, too, because you were talking about television shows, and a lot of people, I think, confuse sometimes, let's say, the evening news or nightly news shows where you're presenting news in an objective way, as objectively as you can, of course, as opposed to interview programs or commentary shows where you have individuals who are doing their own interpretation, their own commentary. And sometimes people mix and match the two, and they shouldn't. Commentary is one thing and reporting is another. You know, my career has been that of a journalist as a reporter, where you actually try to present both sides in an objective way, seek the truth to get out the truth. On the other hand, the commentators can pretty much say what they want based on their own opinions, their own knowledge. So people shouldn't mix and match the two. They are very, very distinct entities.
And one of the things that I found out is that younger people that are getting involved in media sometimes can't tell the difference between what is a news story or a new broadcast or what's opinion. And yeah. I think with the rise of cable news and the need to fill time for 24 hours a day with programming, and you get a lot of these opinion shows, whether it's Rachel Maddow or Chris Cuomo or Anderson Cooper, that are really not news stories but more opinion type of things. It's the line gets very blurred sometimes of what is hard news and what is opinion. And I think that comes just from the change in the media cycle, that the news cycle is 24/7 and programming has to be brought around 24/7 as well.
Yeah, and that gives me pause for reflection, Mark, because I go back a little ways, and I remember when I first got in the business, there were basically three television stations on the television. You'd have your ABC affiliate, you'd have your CBS affiliate, Channel 3 in Hartford, ABC would be 40, 22 would be NBC, and then you might have the PBS station. So you'd basically have three or four stations you watch day in and day out for news and information and that sort of thing. The advent of cable TV and the proliferation of all these stations now, it's incredible the hundreds and hundreds of TV stations you can get on your cable TV now. So that has that has opened up a whole new realm, if you will, of information that's just being bombarded into our airwaves day in and day out, certainly giving people all kinds of different access to news on both sides of the political spectrum, you know, the left, the right. And so it's very, very challenging sometimes in terms of the viewer trying to piece together what is, you know, correct, what is factual, and what is just commentary and opinion.
And the other thing is that has changed, which I find very frustrating as a journalist, is it the tenor is to get the story out there first, be the first one out there with that news piece, then if you've made a mistake, correct it later. And the competition for the viewers' ratings and everything really sometimes supersedes the quality of what's being put out.
Yeah, the last, and you know, you raise a good point there, because the last thing you want to do as a reporter, if you're working on a story, you want to beat the competition. You want to be first with the story. But my philosophy has always been better be accurate, factual, rather than first and then you know, erroneous. So yeah, getting the information straight and factual certainly is much more important in my mind than getting it out on the air. But the pressure is there. And a lot of that, too, is driven, Mark, by the technology that has advanced the business today. For example, when I first got in the business, we would literally go out. We didn't have live trucks or units back then. This was in the late 60s. We would go out and we would film our TV stories every day. We'd have, 16 millimeter film. We'd go out, film our stories. We'd have to come back to the studio, put that film in a processor with chemicals, process the film, and then edit it and chop it up and put it on little reels and run those reels on a projector. And that would be how we got the news stories on the air. My goodness, can you see how time consuming that was? It would take hours and hours to go out, get the story, come back, process it, edit it, and put it on the air. Now with the technology, with live trucks, with live units, you go out to the scene and you are seeing the news as it is happening right there before your very eyes. So that puts a lot of stress on the reporter from a couple of different perspectives. Number one, when you get to a scene and you know, your producers are in your ear about getting that information, we want to go live now. And you've got to try to gather information within a matter of minutes. Sometimes very, very difficult if you can't get people to talk with you. So that adds additional pressure to the reporter who's trying to get that story on first and get it factual. So that puts a whole new burden of pressure, I think, on the reporters out there in the field.
Definitely. And technology has certainly changed. I remember when I started working in radio, there was this huge teletype from the Associated Press, and it was called Rip and Read News at the top of the hour.
Yeah.
And you'd pull the teletype with all the news stories and cut and paste them in some kind of an order. And now with digital things like that, I can put a program together on my laptop, wherever I am, or on my tablet, and produce as high a quality program as I could in the old days, where you went to an office and you had the stationary machine spewing news stories at you. So it certainly made the way that I produce a story or tell a story much different.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's in a way that technology, too, has made it much more simplified in terms of researching a story. You know, all you've got to do is pick up your iPhone and Google this, that, or whatever subject, and you get a proliferation of different stories and information on a particular subject. So that has kind of facilitated gathering information in a sense as well, rather than the old days where you'd have to, you know, try to dig up old newspapers or old stories or copies of stories yourself. But you raise an interesting point, because when we first started in the business, Mark, we would type our stories, believe it or not, on typewriters with carbon paper in the newsroom. We eventually went to electric typewriters, and that was a big advancement. But we'd have carbon paper where an anchor would get one sheet of paper. The producer would get one. The director would get one. The teleprompter would get one. So it was a very burdensome, cumbersome production, if you will, just to get that story on the air, that information on the air. And now you know you've got social media, you've got computers, you've got the technology of digital technology coming into play, so you can present those stories in a much more quick fashion.
Well, Ray, we're just about out of time. So let our listeners and viewers know where they can find Ray Herschel these days.
Well, you certainly can. You touched on it when we first began. I'm doing some work for Connecting Point, which is out of Channel 57 in Springfield, New England Public Media. It's a show that airs every Friday at 6 o'clock. And it's a kind of a local magazine show that has a variety of subjects in it. I do mostly the political segment in it, political interviews within that context. So, you know, people can reach me through PBS in Springfield, NEPM. So there are avenues where, you know, you can get me information or get a story to me.
So I guess you're not going to retire at this point.
You know what? Totally not at this point. You know, God knows what's going to come down the road. But so far, you know, things are working well. I do thoroughly enjoy what I'm doing now at PBS. And that's one of the luxuries, Mark, of being retired. You can do kind of what you like to do within the context of your own time frame. You're not forced to do something. You're not pressured to do things you don't want to do. And this is a genuine pleasure I get out of PBS and doing and helping them out on their political segment on television. And it's something that kind of just dovetail from my own experience as a news reporter in Springfield for 50 years. So it's kind of transitioned me into retirement, if you will, but still allowed me to continue my interest in news and in politics.
Well, it's really great for all of us in Western Massachusetts. And of course, now with digital things, you can watch Connecting Point wherever you are on your computer. You don't have to be in the 413. But it's great to have you around and actively setting the standards here, Ray, for what we come to expect as quality journalism. So thanks for joining us. I hope we get a chance as soon as we're allowed to get out and about. We're so overdue a cup of coffee. So I owe you a latte.
Okay, we might even splurge and have lunch or something, Mark. Who knows?
That sounds great, Ray. We've been chatting with Ray Herschel, who's seen often on Connecting Point on New England Public Media. You are watching On the Mark or listening to On the Mark here on Westfield Community Programming, Channel 15 or 89.5 FM WSKB. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. We're going to take a fast break to acknowledge the underwriters that make this kind of programming possible, and we'll be back with more On the Mark, so don't go away.
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Barnes & Noble College Bookstore in the Ely Campus Center, offering Westfield State t-shirts, sweatshirts, and gift merchandise, all of your academic needs, and offering textbook materials in new, used, ebook and rental formats. Available at the bookstore on campus or online at westfieldstate.bncollege.com.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here.
Hi, this is Harry Rock, host of Rock on Westfield every fourth Wednesday at 8 a.m. Tune in for my view of this place I call home.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back, everyone, to On the Mark. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. We are here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15, 89.5 FM WSKB. Our next guest is Karen Christensen from the Train Campaign. And the trains and railroads are in the news all the time. As you know, there is this major effort underway in Massachusetts to boost train service from the western part of the state to Boston. Those of us that live in the Springfield area have seen a boost in train service from Greenfield to Springfield, and additional train service from Springfield to Hartford, New Haven, connecting with service to New York. And we live in the Northeast Corridor, where many people utilize the rails to travel for business and pleasure. In other parts of the country, they don't have the access to rail service that we have. There are many initiatives underway, and all of us seem to agree on many levels that trains are important, passenger train service in particular is important to Western Mass. And you do see, if you're driving around Westfield, you see Amtrak's Lakeshore Limited goes cruising through town once a day in every direction from Boston to Chicago. It doesn't stop here. In fact, the train was suspended at the beginning of the pandemic, and they've just announced that it's coming back into service. So we're going to spend the next half hour talking about the train service and what's going on in Western Massachusetts and how it could impact and enhance our work lives and our play lives down the road. So welcome.
Thanks so much for having me. Really a treat to be able to talk to someone in Westfield. I've had Westfield kind of on my radar for a while.
Yeah, so let our audience know. I mean, they've heard Senator Eric Lesser talk about the Springfield to Boston service that we want to enhance. And then there have been other initiatives to make sure that it starts in Pittsfield and moves east. What does the train campaign do?
The Train Campaign is a volunteer-led initiative that I started. I'm a global publisher and author, so this is my avocation. And it started when I came back from China. I had ridden a train from Shanghai to Hangzhou for a meeting, and I realized that Hangzhou, which is a very beautiful city, and I happened to be there on the most beautiful day of springtime. And it is also the center. It is a commercial center. It's where Tencent and Alibaba are headquartered, these huge tech companies. So I came back, I flew back from China to New York, and I was meeting one of my colleagues who had come from Sydney, Australia. And the idea was we would meet in New York. We're both jet lagged. And we would take the train up to Great Barrington, which is where I live. And as we were walking through Grand Central, both of us a little groggy, I said, oh, you know, we should have got here early enough to get coffee. And he said, don't worry, Karen, we'll get it on the train. And I just, I thought, you know, the expectations that people from other parts of the world have, we were going to get on a little Metro North train to chug up to Wasaic, where someone was going to pick us up and drive us up to Great Barrington. I thought, this is not the way it should be here. We had train service. Why shouldn't we have train service again? That was 2013. And I knew nothing about trains. I was an English major. This is all new territory for me. But I thought, a business like mine could be able to grow and thrive here, and all kinds of other people would like to have what, you know, I really now think of as the best of both worlds, the best of the city and the best of the beautiful countryside, rural America, and it's Western Massachusetts. As you know, it's a fabulous place.
Oh, I totally agree.
And so this started in the most kind of casual way. I have a monthly newsletter. I wrote about trains because that's what was on my mind. And I just got this outpouring of response from people all over the world saying, yeah, you should have trains there. And I'm an American and I'm embarrassed by this. And So it, and then a couple days later, I walked into a cafe here in town, and the owner said, "So you're going to bring back the trains?" Yeah. That's where the train campaign started.
And it's interesting. I remember as a child, my parents had. I grew up in Springfield, and I did take the train to high school at the time. I went to school in Northfield, and the trains ran up and down the valley. They were discontinued while I was in school. But as a child, I remember my parents had a summer house in Otis, and they would go to Great Barrington, and the train station was there, and they would pick up relatives that would be coming from Grand Central. And I remember, I must have been 4 or 5 years old, but they went to Pittsfield to the Union Station, which was a gorgeous old train station where I think the Big Y is downtown now. It's yeah. been ripped down and all of that. And so I know that you've been working on this plan to get train service to come back to the Berkshires. And right before the pandemic, there was going to be a spur of the New York to Albany trains on Amtrak that was going to come to Pittsfield on the weekends. But I guess that, because of the pandemic, that did not happen.
Yeah, and some legal issues they're having with the freight company as well. There are quite a few different things going on, different initiatives, and they are not. This is not a zero sum game. Trains are systems. They're like airports or roads. They connect lots of places. They don't just go A to B and B to A back and forth. And that's where I'm excited about the potential for Pittsfield, because Pittsfield should be a hub and a transfer point, both on East-West Rail and North-South Rail. And of course, if we can connect our region to both those economic powerhouses, Boston and New York, that will be fabulous for us and actually fabulous for those cities. And then there's Albany in the mix as well. We can't forget Albany.
Now, in Springfield, I mean, there's been this up until the pandemic, there was this increase in train service with the Valley Flyer trains that run from Greenfield to Springfield, and then the CT Rail that runs from Springfield to New Haven. So, and the renovation and rehabilitation of Union Station, and it seemed that up until the pandemic, the ridership was increasing and increasing and increasing. So one would assume that if more trains could get to the Berkshires and they could connect the Berkshires and Springfield and Boston, that it's good for not only business travel, but tourism.
Yes, and one train service tends to amplify another. Obviously, you can't do everything at once, but one needs to see it as a process. And you add components. A number of the services that have been put into place, like the Downeaster from Maine, had beat its projected ridership by a long shot. People really are ready to ride trains again. Obviously, there's going to be a period of transition. And in the United States, we have a lot of challenges. One of the things I've done is start a podcast, the Train Time podcast, that now Transportation for Massachusetts will be sponsoring. And I'm trying to bring in voices from other parts of the country. There are many. I just spoke to a commissioner in Montana. Very similar situation to ours in many ways. They want to bring back service on a line that now has freight, but that used to have passenger service. So we have a couple, they're different kinds of projects. There are projects that are on, for instance, what's called the Northern Tier in Massachusetts, that would go up through Greenfield and to North Adams. And that is a freight line now, as the Housatonic line that I've focused on coming, the old Berkshire line coming up from New York. Then with the East-West line to Springfield and then to Pittsfield, that has other possibilities because it's really a main line. And there's been talk about putting high speed or higher speed, higher performance, as I'm sure you know. And the particular configuration that exists now, as well as the populations that any new service will serve. These things all need to be factored in, and that's where, you know, it's about a lot of people working together make these things happen.
In your estimation, we hear Eric Lesser talk and really push for the Springfield to Boston train service.
Yeah.
You're involved in a lot of the meetings. How are we talking about a year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now? What's a realistic expectation that this might come to fruition?
Well, it in part depends on a federal infrastructure bill, because a federal infrastructure bill might well include a significant amount of money for the East-West project. But it's very interesting. Senator Lesser, a couple weeks ago, there were a lot of bills filed, a number of bills related to rail, Western Mass Rail too, filed in for this legislative session. And Senator Lesser filed a bill that proposed that instead of waiting for a big dig kind of, you know, a project for East-West, that's at least some of the $50 million that is allocated to East-West Rail in the bond bill that was signed late last year, early this year. But there is a transportation bond bill with $50 million that says East-West Rail. And Senator Lesser has proposed that some of that money be spent to put service right now, I mean, ASAP, on the existing line without waiting for any major, you know, double tracking or anything except making an agreement with this CSX, the freight railroad company, and getting in some cars and doing, you know, the other kinds of operational stuff to make it possible to have more train service on this line now, not just the lake. So more sort of to multiply the Lakeshore Limited, to have several of those running a day.
Well, the Lakeshore, there is train service when the Lakeshore Limited comes back. There was train service from Springfield to Boston and Boston to Springfield. And it stopped in Pittsfield, went to Pittsfield and on to Albany. And I actually took it once because I sort of like trains. I took it from South Station to Springfield. And what would normally take me without rush hour traffic, maybe an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minutes to drive, it took close to 2.5 hours. The train was very slow. If I were a leisure traveler, which I was in that case, it's a pretty ride. So there's lots to look at. But I couldn't see somebody running into Boston and coming back. The schedules didn't make it compatible for business travel in any way. With the time constraints and the tracks status and things like that, could they actually do something like that and make it viable for people in Pittsfield and Springfield that want to take the train to Boston for work?
Pittsfield's a little tricky because it's quite a lot farther. So day trips from Pittsfield, the timing, you'd have to leave very early. I've told people, I'm used to going to New York, you know, taking very early trains. Some of us would do that, but for regular daily commuting, probably not.
Yeah.
But Springfield's another story. Springfield's not that far. And there's actually a very, very detailed, very operational plan that's been put, a proposal that's been put together by a group called Transit Matters that would actually make that completely doable for a minimal investment. It is possible. Because one of the things that I've learned about trains, they have to have a place to park at night. And actually, you can often find more space to sort of overnight a train when you get out of Boston. So in fact, there could be a real advantage to overnighting the trains out here and then running them into Boston, picking up people in Worcester and all, going in, rather than parking them there and having to pull them out in the morning, early morning, to take people back in.
Now, I mean, what I know that they need to repair and enhance the tracks from Pittsfield to Springfield and Springfield to Boston. The other train initiative, the one going from Pittsfield down through Connecticut to New York City. What's the status of the tracks there, and how long might it be before train service gets resumed on those tracks?
Well, a wonderful thing that happened under very soon after I started the train campaign and under the leadership of Governor Deval Patrick, the state of Massachusetts purchased the 37 miles of track between Pittsfield and the Connecticut border, and committed another that was about $13 million, and then committed the money to upgrade those tracks to passenger standard. And that work is actually being done now. I live in Great Barrington, not too far from the tracks, and I go down there. In fact, they've already started work this year. There are already new plates out there. The new, it's called welded rail. It's a quarter of a mile long. Instead of these modern trains, the new train service we're going to have, I'm afraid people are some people may miss the clickety clack, because that's not what it's going to be like. That's because there are joints every 25 feet. But this modern rail is a quarter of a mile, and then it's welded. So, so these tracks are going to be of a standard, and a lot of bridge work and crossing work is also being done. So actually in Berkshire County, we're going to have a state investment of getting on for $30 million soon. Now the Connecticut piece has not moved forward as quickly. One of the proposals I saw recently from a transportation consultant is what if you had east-west rail going out to Pittsfield, on any version of it, people could then take the train down to Lee Lenox to Tanglewood or down to Great Barrington on this track. So even before the Connecticut piece to New York is done, that we could have train service with intra-county service here.
And there is a scenic rail that goes up and down every so often, or there used to be.
The scenic rail moved up to the north part of Berkshire County, and there has been talk about bringing it back down here. I'm not sure why that hasn't happened now, since the state now does own the tracks here. That we have a huge advantage on this line. You know, every project has its pros and cons, its pluses and minuses, things that are difficult and things that are easy. Well, in Berkshire County, our advantage is that there's freight traffic on it, but it's not a major freight company. It's a small freight company that has a couple trains a day. So there's not anything like the complications that there are on that main line from Boston to Chicago, the line that will be our east-west rail.
So when, hopefully, the train projects in the Berkshires will get completed, let's say within 5 years.
Yes.
Do you think or do you anticipate that it's going to be the tourists that are using this, or do you think it'll be viable for business people traveling back and forth to New York?
I think it will be absolutely viable for business people, but I think one of the factors is that a lot of companies now are feeling and have learned that remote work can have a lot of advantages for companies as well as for employees, and that they don't need people to be in at the office every single day. I think we're going to see it's not something brand new. We've seen this happening already. People who, you know, work from home on Fridays, you know, that was fairly common in some industries already.
Yeah.
So I think what we're going to see is more of a hybrid working life, where people really, it's kind of the best of both worlds, you know, some of the advantages of working from home, but also the conviviality and the innovation that comes when people are together. And that will mean that, you know, so I think that a lot of transport people are thinking that way, even in Boston, that they're talking not so much about when they restore and build service back up again. It's not going to just be morning and night commuter service. It's going to be spread more evenly through the day, because they're thinking of changing, not, you know, lifestyle patterns and working patterns.
Yeah, just to clarify for people that really want to try rail, that haven't used it. If you're in the Westfield area and you want to take Amtrak, your closest station is Springfield or Windsor Locks, Connecticut, where people generally go, so it's free parking at Windsor Locks.
Oh, okay. But I didn't know that.
For people west of here that, let's say, you know, going up towards Lee in Great Barrington area, how can you take a train now to New York?
There are two ways. Where I live in Great Barrington, and all the way up, actually, I've talked to people all the way up in north part of the county, in Williamstown and North Adams. People drive to Wassaic, New York, which is the very end of the Metro North line. The trains run into New York, into Grand Central, at about every 2 hours. It's not a fancy train. It's a commuter train, you know, with not glamorous by any means, but it's cheap and it's fairly frequent and it's always been extremely reliable, very good timekeeping. Some people go over to Hudson, New York, and get the Amtrak train, which is a beautiful route along the river. It costs more than twice as much. And my experience with Amtrak trains on that line is that they have, like your experience, that they have often been late. I mean, people have mixed experiences. I seem to have bad luck when I take an Amtrak train. They seem always to be late. And they are late because they're tied up by a freight train.
Yeah. I have taken that route. And the cool thing about it is it goes right through Sing Sing Prison, which, they would always announce it. We're going through Sing Sing. And, you know, that was kind of cool. But I tend to take Amtrak from Springfield to New York. The first trains out of Springfield in the morning are on time, and oftentimes the last train back from Penn Station is late, but it's pretty convenient with CT Rail. So to the listeners, if you haven't tried rail and you want to, you have several options from the Berkshires, and you have several options from Springfield along those lines. So you should definitely investigate that. You offer, with the train campaign, a lot of different information, newsletters, and all of that. How can people learn more about what you have to offer and keep in touch with what's going on?
Oh, please visit us at traincampaign.org. And the Train Time podcast, I think, is a really great way to get up to speed, because we've been talking to for instance, Congressman Seth Moulton, who has a high-speed rail proposal, talked to people in Montana. And then to our local, we've had Senator Eric Lesser on a couple of times. And, I'm not a train person. I'm not an engineer. I'm an English major. So I try to make this all as accessible as possible.
And the other thing I was going to say is you have events, or did before the pandemic. So people can go to the site and learn about what's going on.
Yes.
You also need volunteers. Is that right?
I do need volunteers for the podcast, for the website, editing and writing. We see our role as really educating citizens about the potential in the 21st century of passenger rail, how it'll make our lives better and create a more sustainable world and a more dynamic region here. Yeah, we'd love to have people come sign up for our newsletter at traincampaign.org. I'd love to do an event in Westfield, actually.
So if anybody's listening that wants to sponsor an event to let people know in the area about train service and what its potential is, they can reach out to Karen about that. And I understand that there are also some historical resources around where people can tell you about the glory days of the railroads in our area. There are train clubs. There are people that I saw somebody post a photograph of the train station in Chester, which is now an art gallery. And Chester's been proposed in some of these proposals as a potential stop on the East-West Massachusetts train service.
That's right, because it's in the hills between Springfield and
such. Yeah. Is Westfield being considered as a potential?
You know, I think Westfield should be, because Westfield's a major city, And there's absolutely no reason that it shouldn't be. And that's why I'd really love to talk. I'd love to hear from people about that, because Westfield is, you know, you have a university, you're nearly as big as Pittsfield. And we want to make sure that you're part of this picture and.
Well, hopefully somebody will reach out to you. And again, give them the website where they can go.
Yes, traincampaign.org, or on Twitter, traincampaign. And also you'll find us easily on Facebook or Instagram. But Twitter is a good way. And then if you'd like to write to me, it's Karen@BarringtonInstitute.org. The Train Campaign is a project of the Barrington Institute.
Well, Karen, thank you so much for joining us today. We're going to leave everybody with a train song from the Broadway musical On the 20th Century, which was a musical that was based on a play that took place on the famous 20th Century Limited on its 16-hour trip from Chicago to New York's Grand Central Station. Thanks for joining us today on The Mark here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. Karen Christensen from the Train Campaign has been our guest in this segment. If you missed a part of this or want to hear it again, you can find it archived on YouTube on WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. Peter Coles has been our chief engineer today. I'm Mark Auerbach. Thanks for joining us. We'll catch you next Wednesday with another edition of On the Mark.
Wasn't it Robert Fulton who said, "Life is like a train"? No, it wasn't. He said, "Life is like a boat."
Wasn't it Isaac Newton who said, "Life is like a train"? No, it wasn't. He said, "Life is like an apple."
Wasn't it Lord Chesterfield who said, "Life is like a train"? No, it wasn't. He said, "Life is like a coat."
Then who said it? Who said it?
We did. Ha, ha, ha. Ho, ho, ho. Life is like a train. Life is like a train. And aren't we lucky to be making the ride together? Life is like a train. A roaring, rushing train. You get on at the beginning. Along the way you may find a lover, along the way you may find a friend. In case you didn't get the cosmic bug that hit our brain, let us explain once again.
Life is like a train,
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 life is not like an apple,
life is like a train,
life is like a train,
life is like a train.
Life is like a train.
Life is like a T.
Life is like an R.
Life is like an A.
Life is like an
R. Life is like an
N. Life is like a train.
Life is not a boat.
Life is like a train.
Life is not a boat.
Life is like a train.
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 There's always a light at the end of the tunnel. There's always something new round the bend.
But this is our philosophy, and this is our